This looks nice. This is a nice car. What a piece of trash. Wait a second, wait, no, 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 no!
You, contestant regions, if you're dumb enough to buy a new car this weekend, you're a big enough schmuck to come to the Press Corps car dealership. Bad deals, cars that break down, thieves. If you think you're going to find a bargain at Press Corps car dealership, you can kiss my ass. It's our belief that you're such a stupid mother that you'll fall for this bullshit. Guaranteed. If you find a better deal, shove it up your ugly ass. You heard us right, shove it up your ugly ass. Disclaimer.
Troops, I Saw Bear here. Today, we'll be talking about Update 42, dubbed the Winter Army. Now, this is a massive update, probably the biggest we've ever seen. I'll split this up into sections. One is the new regiment system. The second is the small arms race, plus the new vehicles. Third is the new dynamic weather system. And fourth is the artillery update and a new feature known as No Man's Land. Let's start off with the regiment system. This is a clan system. It allows commanders to organize a permanent unit of troops. Regiments can be assigned a name, a five-letter tag, which is unique to all clans since there will be random numbers associated with them to keep them unique, and a Discord server link. Be sure only to include everything after the discord.gg and the slash. Once you've got your regiment set up, you can modify the name at any point you want. You can also leave the regiment or visit its Discord link with the links below, or delete the regiment entirely. In order to invite someone, you can either right-click on their name if they pop up in the text chat, hold the Alt key down and click on them to bring up a contextual menu to invite them, or invite them directly from the regional player list on the F1 screen. From here, you can assign members different ranks. Let's start from the bottom. The first rank is member. This is anyone invited to the regiment and cannot have any administrative roles in the regiment. The next rank up is officer. They can invite or discharge members. The commander is able to promote players to officers and above and can perform all other officer roles. Just be careful. If you promote someone to commander, they are now the ones in charge of the regiment, so don't give it to the wrong person. A benefit to organizing into regiments is that you can see all your regimental members in this screen. You can also go through individual members and check their violation logs, mute them individually, etc. One benefit of this system is you'll be able to see all your regiment members on the right-hand screen, which squads they're currently in, and which region they are operating in. So, using this system, you'll be able to coordinate multiple squads across multiple regions. One important note, regiments are faction locked, so you must leave the regiment in order to change factions. If you wish to disband a regiment, be sure to type in disband in all caps. This is an extra safety system to ensure that all your work doesn't go to waste. Now that your regiments have been sorted out, let's deal with your inventories. We've got a lot of new weapons on the way. I've divided this into some parts. The first part will be the brand new weapons, with some comparisons to legacy weapons. The next part will be the renaming of legacy weapons. Now, when I say legacy weapons, these are weapons that you're already familiar with that have simply been renamed. I won't be covering those in full detail because you should already know how they work. I will only be covering the new weapons. A quick note. Carbines now use rifle ammo, a nice simplification for Lodgy and soldiers alike. Let's kick things off with the Cascadier 873. This is a burst machine pistol, 12 rounds, 3 round bursts, Warden specific.
Alright, cool.
Fire and then keep firing when your reticles are fully on target until you have exhausted all rounds and do not reload, so go when ready. For snipe rifles, the Wardens retain the Legacy Clancy Raka M4, 5 rounds, bolt-action snipe rifle. While the Colonials get the KRR3792 Auger. This is a semi-automatic sniper rifle. While it has a faster fire rate and faster stability time, it is overall less accurate. If you're out of ammo, just unzoom. Okay, same exercise. Ready, set, go. Colonials get two new sets of rifles, the Fushina PI-1 burst rifle and the Argenti R-2 semi-auto rifle. Okay, open fire, guys. The Colonials also now have access to the Pitch Gun. This is an SMG, however, it's a secondary slot weapon, so it can be used from side seat positions or commander seat positions in vehicles. Okay, fire at will. For medium machine guns, the Colonials get the Ghast, and the Wardens get the Malone Mark II. The Ghast comes with 75 rounds and has a generally slower fire rate, while the Malone boasts 125 rounds and a faster fire rate. Thank you, Mint. Note that both of these can be mounted while standing in a trench. The Colonials also now have switched out to have their own standard frag grenade, and it is called the Bombastone. It is a stick-style fragmentation grenade. For anti-tank launchers, the Colonials have access to several new options. The Ignifist 30. This is a single-use launcher. They also have access to the Venom C235 and the Bane 45. The Venom is lighter and can be used in all positions, while the Bane 45 is heavy and needs to be used from a standing position. Okay, that works for me. The Wardens also get access to the Cutler Launcher 4. This is a fairly light anti-tank launcher. Before I continue on, there's a new class of weapons we have to talk about, tripod-mounted weapons. These come in two parts, the mounted weapon and the tripod, of course. You can use these as one soldier, but it's definitely best to use them as a crew. First, you must place down the tripod with the B key. It can only be placed in a very close proximity to your soldier, so practice setting them up in rapid succession. Next, you need the mounted weapon. This goes on top of a placed tripod. Once this is all set up, your soldier's inventory will be accessed when you mount the weapon. You don't need to load ammo into him specifically. This example here is the Daukus ISG-3. It's an infantry support gun. It fires anti-tank rounds in rapid succession. Once you're done, press the E key to take the gun down. It'll come in two parts, and hopefully two soldiers will bring it back. Also note that any ammo left inside of these guns will drop on the ground when you disassemble the weapon. So, speaking of this, the Wardens also have access to the Bonesaw Mark III. This is an indirect fire anti-tank weapon. Don't worry if I destroy the target. It can fire over objects and does a significant amount of damage. It's fine. Alright guys, go set up. Additionally, there is a mounted Bonesaw Mark III that requires a tripod for use. Fire one round. Right at the tank. Nice. One other weapon I'll briefly mention is the Alto Storm Rifle 24. This is now a Warden-specific weapon. Although nothing has changed about its function, it does have a new model and different sounds, so get used to hearing this on the battlefield. That does it for all the new weapons. And because I'm lazy, here is a brief list of all the old weapons, which faction they now belong to, and what they are now called. I'm forgetting something, aren't I? Oh, right. Vehicles. There are several brand new vehicles with this update. First off is the King Spire Mark I Scout Tank. It has a crew of three, gunner, driver, and commander. Fires 12.7 MG rounds and is equipped with a radio kit for intel gathering. Also note that any vehicles equipped with a radio kit, such as LUVs, now no longer need to be stationary in order to receive radio intel. They can do so on the move. Next up is the 85KB Falchion, medium tank for the Colonials. Three crew, driver, gunner, and commander, a 40mm gun, fast turret traverse, and is exceedingly cheap when produced from mass production factories.
Lieutenant, best tank. Oh no, our engine, what would we do?
Lose and die.
Warden light tank don't need no engine.
Yeah, they don't need no chassis either.
Lastly for the Wardens, we have the Devitt Kane Mark IV MMR. This is a mortar tank. It's a converted light tank, has a crew of three, gunner, driver, and commander, and fires all types of mortar rounds. This is definitely a Warden answer to the Colonial mortar half-track. I hope you've packed your overcoats for the next one. Now, we're going to talk about the new dynamic weather events. These are weather events that will occur around the world. Each type of weather has varying levels of intensity, and not all weather storms are the same size. Some could be smaller than a region, some could encompass multiple regions. The two types of weather events are snowstorms and rainstorms. Snowstorms make the world cold and cover the ground in snow. Your soldier and vehicles will be affected by this cold. In heavy snow conditions and snowstorm conditions, you will suffer from freezing. This is indicated in the top left by your status bar. In order to combat the effects of cold, you can either seek shelter in broken or built buildings, defenses such as trenches or foxholes. Sitting inside of a vehicle is also another way for your soldier to keep warm. Open-top vehicles will not provide warmth during snowstorms. The best way to combat the cold is with a campfire. Campfires are built using basic materials and fueled with diesel, and the flame size will actually correspond with how much fuel is left in the fire. Now, it'll take a few minutes for you to freeze to death, but that's if you stand completely away from campfires or buildings and do nothing to improve your situation. It should be avoidable for most cases. Snow also messes with off-road terrain. It makes vehicle traversal slower on off-road terrains, unless you have a vehicle with large treads adapted for this. The Wardens, being from the north, have the following vehicles you see on screen now, more adapted with their larger treads, so they'll have an easier time off-road. You'll also note that on your soldier model and vehicle models, snow will accumulate, which indicates how cold they are getting. Note that freezing vehicles does not apply for field weapons that are simply pushed. Vehicles can also freeze. However, if you have a driver running the engine of a vehicle, it will not freeze. It will only freeze if the vehicle has been abandoned in the snow or has run out of fuel for its engine. To unfreeze vehicles, simply light a campfire beside them. Regions with rivers and lakes, and even coastal areas on the sea, can become frozen during snowstorms, which might wreck shipping lanes, but also gives you way more surface area to cross rivers and bodies of water. Visibility is also reduced. There's another thing about wind, but I'll talk about that in a little bit. Rainstorms follow a somewhat similar pattern. There's light rain, heavy rain, and rainstorms. The main deal with rain is it will turn dirt and field terrain into mud. You'll also have an indicator in the top left for mud as well. As your soldier walks, crouches, and crawls through mud, they will gain carry weight because of all the mud on their uniform. It will weigh you down if you keep crawling through the mud, especially in Tier 1 trenches. The easiest way to deal with mud is to sit out in the rain on a non-dirt surface and let it wash off. However, this takes a long time, so I might suggest finding the nearest body of water and going in for a little bit of a swim. The maximum encumbrance from mud you can attain is 50%. Additionally, map intelligence radius on all sources during rainstorms is reduced by 50%, so observation towers and watchtowers will have a 50% smaller radius, or about 30 meters. Wind also changes during rainstorms, but again, we'll cover that in just a second. The last part of this update might give you a little bit of a shock. This is a rework of the artillery system.
Yeah, you're fine.
Let's start with the basics. There is a new bunker facility, the ammunition room. Ammunition rooms are constructed on tier 3 bunkers with concrete. Once these rooms are built, these act as storage boxes for artillery shells. What makes them different is the ability to quickly pull shells from the rack to feed into artillery positions. Not to mention, the rack will actually show an exact count for the amount of shells stored in that rack. Note that these will only serve to store artillery shells and not things like tank shells or mortar shells. The old field artillery and howitzer artillery are no longer in Foxhole. They have now been replaced by new faction-specific artillery pieces. And all of these pieces do not have an inventory. They will have to be fed shells one by one from racks like these. So artillery positions are now going to have a whole new layout, as these positions are meant to be a bit more static and less throwaway. For light artillery, the Colonials have 20-120 Coronides field gun. Much like the old field artillery, it's pushable and fires 120mm shells. For the Wardens, they get the Hubert Lariat 120mm. This is a stationary emplaced gun.
Bombs away.
Next, for the heavy artillery, we've got the Colonial 50-500 Thunderbolt cannon firing 150mm shells. And for the Wardens, it's the Hubert Exalt 150mm.
I'm gonna kiss the bridge.
All artillery pieces in Foxhole now fire further than their previous counterparts. However, they are less accurate, and I'll explain how. Artillery pieces no longer work like long-range sniper rifles. Now they have a rough radius of where shells will land, and this radius increases as the range increases. So if you fire at a target closer to the gun, you're more likely to hit it. But if you fire at a target, let's say 300 meters away, you are less likely to hit it with a direct round. So this encourages troops to amass artillery pieces together to form bombardment lines rather than single pieces used as long-range snipers. Additionally, wind now plays a factor in artillery ranging. Wind will throw your shells off in the direction the wind is traveling. And how do you tell this? Foxholes, watchtowers, all those little flags on bases you see now indicate which direction the wind is traveling in. So you can use these as markers to determine where you should be aiming your rounds. And this will even extend the range of your guns. If your gun ranges at a maximum of 300 meters, but the wind is traveling the same direction that you're firing in, you can actually use that to send the shells from your guns even further than they could normally. And as I said earlier, weather events, such as snowstorms and rainstorms, will affect wind direction and speed a lot more frequently than calm days. These effects also apply from light artillery to heavy artillery to gunboat artillery, mortars, and storm cannons. But that's only half of the artillery update. What happens to the receiving end? Well, I'm glad you asked. Artillery fire can now cause the landscape to be permanently devastated in Foxhole. Grassy fields will get turned to dirt fields, and during rainstorms, muddy fields. This devastation occurs slowly and over time. It'll take a lot of battles in an area to really fully devastate it. But whole towns and their garrison houses can be wiped off the face of the map over time. Forests, umbral wildwood, can be leveled, burned, and turned into nothing more than a muddy field with a bunch of dead trees. Artillery also has a chance to leave impact craters, which you and fellow soldiers could actually use for cover, and this opens up so many new opportunities for tactics and strategies involving devastating the landscape or trying to hold off blowing towns to bits to maybe have a better chance of actually occupying them. Okay, those were the main changes. I'll skim through these other changes relatively quickly. Some gameplay changes include damage type system. Every type of ammunition now has damage type that defines how damage is mitigated against structures, vehicles, and the chance to penetrate tank armor. Certain weapons will no longer penetrate or deflect off tank armor, and instead deal mitigated damage against armored targets. This mostly applies to small arms. Border bases will now include faction-specific weapons and diesel as part of their starter equipment. Full repair action at garages is now no longer available on enemy vehicles. There's an increased vertical aiming arc threshold, so it's easier to shoot targets below you. Squad locks are now cleared on vehicles and storm cannons when the squad in question is disbanded. Some balances include all legacy weapon stats have been updated, so effectively they should be treated like new weapons, even though functionally they're the same. Gunboat class vehicles now mitigate the majority of small arms, that is to say, light kinetic damage. Diesel retrieval time has been reduced by 50%, and diesel encumbrance has also been reduced by 10%. The O'Brien V110, the Ziphos, and the Percutio acceleration has been increased by 17%, but off-road speed has been decreased by 10%. The O'Brien Highlander acceleration has increased by 50%. Tier 3 Ziphos, an O'Brien Highlander, and O'Brien V110 turret rotation speed has been increased by 25%. All armored vehicle car classes' braking power has been increased by approximately 50%. The HHA Javelin, HHB Hoplite, and HHD Peltast, Niska Mark 1 gun motor carriage, have all had their top speeds increased by 10%, but acceleration decreased by 10% as well. The H10 Pelicus reload time has been reduced from 4.5 to 3.5 seconds. 68mm ammo damage against structures has been reduced by 10 to 20%, depending on their tier. 68mm shell tank penetration chance has been reduced by 40%. All vehicles with tank armor are now highly resistant to kinetic weapons, such as rifles, MGs, etc. Light tank mobility has been increased. The Silver Hand has had its agility slightly reduced, but has also had its armor increased by 5%. The Niska Mark II Blinder range has been increased from 40 to 45 meters. The T-12 Action tankette cost has been reduced from 60 down to 50 RMATs. It's had its range increased from 35 to 40. It's also had its accuracy increased, and its inventory capacity increased from 1 to 4. Mortar costs and crate sizes have been updated to reflect their new functionality. Storm cannon minimum range has increased from 325 to 400 meters. Storm cannon rotation power consumption has decreased by 10%. All mortars, handheld or vehicle variants, have had their damage decreased by 40% and have had their range increased to 80 meters. A map change has occurred in Viper Pits, where the seaport has been relocated. Home region tutorials have been updated, as well as layouts to accommodate the new artillery training range. Some other changes include improved sound effects for automatic weapons, heavy vehicle damage, status, visual effects have been updated. The left mouse button can now be used to submit large objects to structures or vehicles. This is especially important for the artillery update, since you can now submit shells you're carrying directly to the gun. Weapons and ammunition now display tooltips with detailed information on the damage type characteristics, supported ammunition, and special behavior. Oh yeah, and enemies can now be globally muted from the options menu. I'll be honest, there was a lot in this update. I probably missed something somewhere or got something wrong. I apologize. If I did, I will leave that in the comment section down below, in a pinned comment. So please do check that. And if there's anything else I missed or you want to read up on something again, I highly recommend you check out the patch notes down below, as always. Welcome to the new front line. Enjoy your stay, and try to stay warm. If you like what you saw in this update, like, subscribe, and share it with everyone. Everyone needs to know this information. And as always, good luck. Keep your heads down, and stay in your foxholes. or your shell craters, or your trenches, or your vehicle, or wherever is safe. Bear, out.